people don't plan to fail. They just fail to plan. So if you're not budgeting, if you have a target, you definitely budget. Mm. You will take some steps that will help you achieve that. But if the man does not believe in, you know, in budgeting and financial management, I think they are heading for disaster as far as I'm concerned. So if the woman can find a means, a way to convince the man and let him see reason why this has to be done. You know, sometimes we just need to communicate and let things, you know, be done properly. You know, you need to win. I mean, I don't see anybody in their, you know, right sense not wanting to comply with something that is going to bring dividends, you know, good results to the family. Mm. So if you said we're budgeting and this is to help us know where we're going, I mean, if I'm in my right sense, I should be able to support that.
Sorry, yeah. Sir, if I may come in. The woman says the husband believes that is lack of faith.
Faith, you know, okay. Yeah.
You know, and there is this saying that Jesus is coming. So if Jesus is coming, some people believe, why should they plan for tomorrow?
Yeah, I think that is getting it wrong. Thinking as a Christian, you don't have to plan. And if you don't plan, even Jesus went before he multiplied. We're given the number of women. And men, and not talk about women and children. So, calculation has been done, you know. And then this multiplication came, and we were still told what was left. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure things were taken into account. So, if you're a man, if you think budgeting is out of faith, okay. I think it's not getting it right. To be honest,
yeah, that's how a lot of Christians. They abdicate their responsibility. They haven't read the Bible.
No.
They haven't read it. Most of these people who call themselves Christian and quote and say and make sentences, a statement like that, they haven't read the Bible. Because the Bible I read, it says, know the state of your flock.
Mm-hmm.
And it's talking to farmers.
Yeah.
Yes? And then the other one, it says, if you were going to build,
yeah.
Will you not sit down and calculate?
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
And count the cost.
Yeah.
So people want to use the Bible for everything, but when they lack something, and look at that. Remember the five, the three servants.
Yeah.
Who were given the talent.
Talents, yeah.
Look at what that the day I preach that passage to my children all the time. Look at what he said, what the master said about the guy who buried his talent. He said, "You wicked." He didn't kill anybody. He didn't steal. In fact, he actually preserved it. And then he called him wicked.
Mm-hmm.
The thing God has given to us is our gifts, our talents. And when we fail to use it in whatever form to add value, we're going to be held accountable. It's very, very important.
Mm.
So we might start quoting the Bible, because on that day, God is going to say, I am the Bible. You quote it to me.
Thank you.
So anybody who is saying you lack of faith, that's why I'm saying that is it's a load of rubbish.
Yeah.
It's all rubbish. So go and sit down. And go and do your calculation, because if you are going on a journey, you need to know how long it will take you. You know how much it will cost you.
Yeah.
You can't just get up and say you want to go and do something. And that's why, sadly, there's so much poverty among people and Christians.
Yeah.
Because the Bible says the children of this world, they are wiser.
Yeah, you're right.
They are wiser than the children of the kingdom.
Hmm.
Why? Because we are supposed to be far better and wiser, because the Holy Spirit, we have the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, yeah.
So let anybody not quote the Bible for me.
Wrong.
No, that is not. It's not the Bible. It's his misinterpretation.
Yes.
And he needs to plan. God expects us to plan. Look at the five virgins.
Yeah.
Will you say they didn't have faith?
Mm.
Why is Jesus telling us such stories?
Mm.
Five were foolish. Five were wise. The wise one took additional oil.
Mm.
Is it because they didn't have faith? Well, good for their faith, because
it works for them.
It works for them. But I would rather take it and not have faith, but plan for it.
I like that. I really like that.
Yeah, even God, Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know their plans." So God is a planner.
Is it? Of course.
It's God's plans. I think Proverbs 24:3, it says, "With wisdom, a house is built with wisdom." And it said, "With understanding is established." So the Bible is meant to provide you with wisdom, and then begin to, and then the last verse said, "With knowledge is filled with outstanding stuff."
Yeah.
So if you got the Bible, should give you knowledge, should give you wisdom, understanding, and all that.
Planning for the future.
For the future.
I have this saying that we don't overinvest so that we're living in poverty now, and then you don't live long enough to enjoy what you have invested, or finish everything now and then find that you live long and there is nothing. There's always a balance. The rule of thumb for me is 70-30. 70-30. If you live on 70% of what you earn and save 10%, take it up to 20, 10, the first 10% as Christians is for tithing. But if you learn to save 10% of your income every month without fail, then you are onto a good start. Somebody once said to me, "Oh, I say I earn £2,000 net, and you want me to save £200 or 10% of that. What would that do?" I said, "A lot. A lot." Because when you say 10%, that's math student, is that 200?
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Yeah.
£200, you're saving £200, and you say, "How can I save £200? You can easily save £200 because a lot of us, we waste money. £200 in your account, in 3 months, you have £600. £600, split that into, buy shares in your utility company. You have gas, you have electric, you have water. Nobody is asking you to come out with £1 million. Rome was not built in a day.
Yeah.
So, because if you, can you imagine saving £200 and you don't take out of it for 10 years?
Mm.
Or let's not take it, 5 years. You've worked for 5 years and you earn £200 consistently.
Mm.
At the end of 5 years, you will have something.
Of course. Of course.
But people say to me, "How can I save? The money is not enough." I said, the reason the money is not enough is that you are waiting to save at the end. treat your savings just like the inland revenue treats you.
Take it out first.
You take it out
before
first.
You even start spending.
And whatever is left, that's what we've got for the week or for the month. If it's not enough, then we fast. 30%. Put it aside, you don't spend it. Live on 70% of your income.
God help us.
It might be difficult.
We'll help
ourselves. But that is where money management comes in.
It takes discipline, though.
Money management. You have to sit down. Mm-hmm. How much does it cost us to pay? Well, how much does the mortgage cost?
Mm.
You know.
Yeah.
How much does it cost on gas, electricity, and water?
Yeah.
You know.
Mm.
How much does it cost? When I was raising children, 4 children, when I was raising them, we had a menu. When I go shopping for menu, for the food in the house, when I go into Tesco and they say, "Buy one, get 10 free." If it's not on my menu, I'm not buying it, even if it's for free.
Yeah. Right.
Because you buy the one and take the 10 home, and it ends up in the bin. So you have a menu. On Monday, this is what we are going to eat. On Tuesday, this is what we are going to eat. And so when you go shopping, you buy what you need.
You stick to the budget.
You stick to the budget. I'm not an investment specialist. But I can give from my own experience. Okay? Now, you start from the little ones to the heavy ones. I starting from the savings. Savings is an investment.
Yeah.
And the fact is that people think, you have to have a big deposit. You have to have a large amount to be able to invest. I said, no. Even in this country, the government has made it so easy for people to save and save sensibly without the tax impacting ISA.
Yeah.
15,240 every year. And you don't have to have the 15,000. Whatever you have, put it in an ISA. And for those who haven't got a home now, they've even come up with this scheme that if you save in an ISA, the government gives you like for like contribution. I don't know the precise amount. So let's start with where we are. Even if it's £10 you are saving every month, be diligent with it. And don't keep it where your eyes will see it and you say, oh, now it's £500, now wow, I'm rich. And you go, no. Put it in a different account, in a different branch, where you don't link it up. So at the end of 3 months, you see what you have. Okay, you split it 3 ways. And maybe I would like to buy some shares in Tesco. Yeah. Why not? You go there to shop every time.
Yeah.
Or Sainsbury's. Mm. And somebody said, don't you need 1,000 or 2,000, 3,000? Have you gone to ask them in your bank? Say to your bank, you want to have a share account.
Mm.
And they say to you, oh, no, you must come with 20,000. Mm. There are the people they ask for 20,000, but you just want a few shares.
Yeah.
So long as you don't mind paying the little the transaction cost, which comes with every investment,
mm-hmm.
then that's it. So you have your shares. You have the national savings account, which is the post office, the old post office.
Mm-hmm.
Save for the children. If you have some money, once you have accumulated it, look around for government bonds.
Yeah.
If the government, you lend the money to the government and it gives you some returns.
Mm.
And they are tax-free.
Mm.
Yeah. Do you understand? Amazing. So there are so many things. People are just looking for big business where they will earn millions.
I think that's where the problem
is.
Yeah.
No, it's little by little. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Compounding effect of what we do.
Yeah.
So
drops of water makes a
nation. Exactly, little drips.
Yeah.